This video is based on a recording of a live event. It contains additional content to help the audience understand the context of the topic presented. If you wish to skip directly to the primary topic, see the timestamps in the video description.
So good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, wherever you're going to be logging in from. Thank you for joining. My name is Chandler McCann. I am a field CTO here at DataRobot. And I'm super excited to come to you live on our first LinkedIn Live for AI Accelerators. And so looking forward to sharing a little bit about the project itself, as well as going through one of my favorite topics about leveraging feature discovery with Snowflake. So before we jump in, just a little bit about myself. I have been in the machine learning and applied statistics space for about the last better part of the last 20 years. And ranging from ultra high volume semiconductor manufacturing to working with the Army in Afghanistan for supply chain optimization, to most recently working at DataRobot for the last 5.5 years, where I've had the opportunity and the chance to work with a huge range of customers. So between the federal government, with agencies like HHS, working on the vaccine trials for COVID, to some of the world's largest retailers and banks on some of their most difficult machine learning problems, to also starting our AI for Good program back in 2019, where I've had the opportunity to work with nation leaders in places like Sierra Leone and Liberia to help them apply machine learning to their data to improve public health issues like access to water. So in all those, what's been really useful for me as a data scientist has been the ability to leverage DataRobot's Python API to really collapse the cycle time for applying machine learning in these scenarios. And that's really the impetus behind AI Accelerators. So let me go ahead and share my screen, and we'll touch briefly on what those are, and then we'll dive into our use case here. What exactly are AI Accelerators? At their core, they're simply repeatable code-first workflows that are meant to help you collapse your time to value. So our customer-facing data science team has been helping solve problems in machine learning around the world for the better part of the last 10 years. And we want to share that knowledge with our customers and data science community and create a discussion. So they come in a couple of different flavors, and we're going to be expanding this out a lot. But in their kind of the most basic level, some simple examples of end-to-end workflows across our major integration partners like GCP and Snowflake, to workflows in some of the more evolving tools that data scientists are using today, such as MLflow, or more focused examples inside of DataRobot. So things like demand forecasting, dealing with cold starts and segment modeling in time series. So covering a wide range, but ultimately we want to share that knowledge with our stakeholders. And as I mentioned, you can find these on our DataRobot community page. And for example, here is the demand forecasting, as well as the example on MLflow. And so I encourage you to go and check these out, and we'll be sharing those in the links here shortly. And you can also find them on our GitHub page here. And this is the one that I'll be going through today. So I'm excited to talk to you about automated feature discovery. It's one of my favorite tools inside DataRobot, and it's really super powered when combined with Snowflake to push down compute and accelerate the discovery process. So let's go ahead and start talking through the use case, and I'll go ahead and give you some background. So why did I pick this one? Because this comes up all the time. And so the reality is the data you want for training often is in more than one place, right? So it's generally spread out across different data sets. And this can create a number of challenges. So what we're seeing on the screen here is the example that's inside of the notebook. We'll be going through it in a second. But if we're looking at a loan default scenario, you could have the thing you want to predict, which is, for example, the customer and if they are going to default or not, or if they have defaulted. And then you may have some information on their transactions, right? So so information that is a one-to-many relationship with the customer ID itself and their account over time. And then you have some, maybe some static information about when they applied for the loan or became a customer. It's really common in banking, like KYC data. So how you handle all this actually creates or raises a ton of questions that come up. So for example, how should you aggregate your data, right? So how far back in time should you go? 1 month, 2 weeks, 1 week. So you know, that's one kind of dimension there. As well, how should you handle the data inside of each of the data sets? So this description data, right? So the type of transaction, should I try to synthesize this to a few categories? Should I treat it as text or categorical? What's going to be my approach inside my pipeline? And finally, which data to use, right? So are there other data sources besides these three that would be really helpful? Should I only use data from the time of application, or do I have more recent information on their employment status? So there's a lot of questions that could come up. And the challenge is, and what we want to shortcut, is that people tend to take the path of least resistance to their MVP model, right? Which is not wrong. You know, you want to be expeditious and kind of accelerate the learning cycles in your process. And on the left is meant to be an eye chart. It is from the recent paper, is pretty popular in the MLOps space, but talks about the future engineering pipeline or the entire MLOps pipeline. And I'm highlighting this because what people tend to do in the field is use what's around, right? And that makes complete sense. You could perhaps use data that you have in the feature store. You could use data that you've used in previous projects. But the downside of that is that, you know, it's a really strong assumption that the features you've built in the past are necessarily going to be predictive and generalized to other use cases. So that's just causing delays and the time it takes to learn. And also you're necessarily limiting yourself to data sets you've used in the past, different features and joins you've used in the past. So what we want to do is really collapse all this. And so let's just stick with this example here. Let's say that you get a model out and you're ready to deploy. There's a number of other challenges that come up when you have lots of different data sources in one place. So for example, different aggregations for time. If you have a data set that's being recorded in the minutes, another one that's in the hours, keeping track of those and managing those well over time. In addition to things like text and categoricals over time, summarizing those can create a lot of issues, especially with your modeling pipeline. So these are really time intensive to create. And I would also add on the right-hand side, when you look at a lot of event-based data, humans are generally involved, and long and short-term effects could come into play. And what I mean is, you know, what was predictive 2 months ago with this like 30-day window may not matter anymore. So it's not as simple as just retraining your model. You may have to go back and start over in this pipeline and try to figure out which data to use that's going to add signal to your use case. So we're going to provide an approach today that's a repeatable framework that you can use to address all these challenges. And what we're showing here on the screen is what we're going to touch on, but an automatic way to define your experimental considerations. So where you want to define your lag features here on the left, how you want to define your joins, and really collapse that time to develop models, iterate, and ultimately get to production. So the big things we're going to walk through, I'm going to switch over to the actual accelerator that you can go and clone today. It's available. But I want to touch on a few points. So we're not going to walk through everything line by line. But first is just how do you start building that MLOps pipeline for governance? The second is how to actually configure time-aware feature engineering and get that specific to your use case. And the third is how we're going to deploy. In this case, we'll be, again, deploying into Snowflake. But this would work with any other database that you may have. So I'm going to go ahead and move over to an actual, so this is our notebook here. And so touching on the first part of MLOps, you can see that I've just got pull this into Jupyter. And If you're a Snowflake customer, just update your credentials and you can pull the data right into your warehouse. And so we're using a public data set. And just by running this and adding your credentials, you can load your data in. Again, if you're not using Snowflake, you can access the data and still follow along and apply this to your own workflow. But the first thing we want to do is, you know, we've got our data now. So say we have our profile data, we have our transactions data, it's all loaded. That's fine, but we want to version these data sets so that they we have the complete lineage from our training data to our prediction data over time. So that's step one, and that's going to occur over here on the left. So after you pull data into Snowflake, it's going to walk you through setting up Snowflake as what we call a data store. And all that's going to do is going to allow you to create version data sets of each of these. So what we're doing here is pulling from the actual table that we just created, running that query from the database, and creating this new data set inside of DataRobot's AI catalog. So what you'll see is after you run this, you're going to have, you know, a instance of this data set. We can see that it came from Snowflake. We have a version ID here, and we can now, as we make predictions over time, you can repeat this process to other use cases. It's going to always keep track of, you know, where the prediction came from and the source data that it was fed for either training or scoring. So this is a big part of our first ML, our first piece of the puzzle, and we're going to do this for each of the data sets here. So after that's done for your, you know, the profile data set, so the one that contains, is this person going to default or not, the transaction data, and the target data. What we're really interested in is configuring our time-aware feature engineering. So what do I mean? So we want to end up over here. It's what we showed before, and I can zoom in. So where we'd like to be is, instead of manually coding features, we want to define, hey, I am interested in a 7-day lag, a 14-day lag, and a 30-day lag from my prediction point. And I want to join that to on customer ID and join that to my target data set that has if this person defaulted or not. And so it's really easy. So you can go ahead, and if you're following along your notebook, you'll start a project in DataRobot that we've done up here. And we've gone ahead and we've identified what are the parameters you can use to build different features. So in this case, we are looking at the, you know, these true or false flags could turn on a number of different things. And if you do this, for example, you can turn off which do I want to compute categorical statistics or enable text analytics with like word count or token counts, etc. All configurable, and you can store this and use it again to keep track of your experiments over time. And once you do that, the next thing you're going to want to do is also define those windows. So up in the section here, I'm not going to go through this line by line, but if you want to explore different feature derivation windows like we're talking about, those short and long-term effects, all can be configured right here just by updating your dates. So these code blocks will walk you through how to join your data. Very simple to do. And but the benefit of this is once you're ready and you've, what have we done? We've got our tables, you know, registered. We've defined sort of our experimental parameters to build some features. Now I want to build models. In this section here, it's going to simply say, hey, this is the thing I'm trying to predict. Let's go ahead and pass in the data sets that I'm interested in. So these transactions, the profile, I've got my feature engineering options. And when you do this, that's going to create what we were looking at before. This is going to go ahead, go inside DataRobot, and based on these parameters here, build different features as well as and it's just going to explore them and actually pass on ones. It's going to go through and do some feature reductions so you're not getting all the ones that may not be providing signal. So just to kind of keep things moving here, this is what the output will look like. So you can see it's gone ahead and pulled in a number of or different variables. You could explore some of these, but the benefit here is I didn't have to go in and actually engineer all these features itself. All the SQL is available for you to use, and you can download from within the notebook. So the first part is going to build the features. Second part is that block of code is going to actually run the experiment itself. And if you do that, it's going to come up with a model that performs best based on the metric that you've identified. This is a baseline notebook. I strongly encourage you to go and explore and evaluate a lot of different feature lists and techniques before you settle on a final model. But one thing to call out is that the diversity of the features that we're looking at here, so the variation in their purchasing behavior, the lag time between transactions, are all adding signal, as well as some of those harder to handle features that contain text like purpose, et cetera. So all that's going to be accomplished here. And you can select that base model from here. Again, really encourage you to explore what makes sense for you. Well, thank you all. Have a great day.